Hi everyone. My talk today is, the subtitle is Microbiome and Alzheimer's in 10 minutes or less. So I hope I can give you some useful information. Thank you, Sterling, for that great overview. Thank you, Will, for your really thoughtful comments. And thank you to all of you for being here tonight. Your participation, as you know, really means a lot and means that we can show you some new findings tonight. So many of you have probably heard the term microbiome. Maybe you've heard it in the news. But for those of you that haven't heard that term, it basically refers to microorganisms, tiny little organisms, and the particular environment that they live in, and the genes that are associated with those microorganisms. And we're interested in the human microbiome, and especially the gut microbiome. So why microbiome and Alzheimer's disease? So these microbes that live in our bodies have been associated with a number of diseases, and there seems to be more and more studies coming out suggesting that the microbes that live in our bodies are important for health. And there have even been studies linking microbes with brain diseases, including psychiatric conditions, Parkinson's disease, and then very recently, potentially with Alzheimer's disease. Some studies even suggesting that microbes can get into the brain, perhaps microbes that aren't supposed to be there. So far, though, the studies have been fairly small. We don't know if they're going to replicate, but there seems to be enough signal there suggesting that this could be something important that we should look at. So in Wisconsin, we've started a study to look at microbiome and Alzheimer's disease. You are not alone. So you have trillions of microbes on and in your body. There's at least as many microbial cells in and on your body as there are human cells, and perhaps even more. Sometimes when we talk about microbes or bacteria or germs, what comes to mind is maybe a cause of illness, something that we need to get rid of. But it turns out to be the case that the majority of microbes in your body are actually really important for health. And the majority of microbes in your body reside in the gut, and they play very essential roles. So for example, the food that you've eaten this evening, the nutrients that you are able to absorb from that food is thanks to the microbes in your gut. We also know that microbes play a role in developing an active immune system, and that microbes are important for the energy that we extract from our food and how much fat we'll absorb from our food. Let me just give you an example. So there's a very talented investigator here at UW-Madison, Federico Rey, who runs a lab that studies animals who are kept germ-free. So these are mice that have never been exposed to any germs. They're kept in a bubble. And what you can do then is expose these animals to microbes and see whether how that contributes to health factors or disease. So what's super fascinating about these mice is that they've never been exposed to any germs, and if you feed them a high-fat, high-sugar diet, the animals don't gain weight, and they don't develop insulin resistance or features of diabetes like you might expect a mouse on a high-fat, high-sugar diet would happen. But by the way, we're not selling these sterile environments for personal use. What's really interesting is if you then take this a step further. So Dr. Rey was a co-author on a science paper where they did a really interesting study, and they took fecal samples from twins who were discordant for obesity. So one twin was obese and the other twin was not obese. And then they took stool samples and gave them to these mice that had never been exposed to any germs. And what they found was that when they gave the mice the stool sample from the obese twin, that the animals then gained weight. And if you give the mice a stool sample from a normal weight person, the animals don't gain weight. So there's clearly something in those microbes that is contributing to obesity. So does the gut microbiome play a role in Alzheimer's? We don't know, but we have some very early data that we showed at the meeting in London. And essentially, we're asking three questions. So first of all, is gut microbiome different between people with dementia due to Alzheimer's and control? Do the contents of the gut, the microbes in the gut, do they possibly contribute to the development of specific features of Alzheimer's, such as plaques and tangles? And we're asking this using some of the tools that Dr. Johnson described, the neuroimaging, but also the cerebral spinal fluid. And then finally, can we use this germ-free animal model to maybe more directly answer this question? So in order to answer this question, we turned to you all and we asked you to send us your poop. And you answered the call of research and the call of nature, and you boxed up your samples and you sent them to us. And actually, we have someone from Dr. Ray's lab here who received your samples, but don't worry, he doesn't know who gave their samples. Then we performed DNA sequencing on these so we could tell what was there and how much of it. So we looked at diversity and abundance. So we want to know, for example, are there a lot of different species? And then of each one, how much is there? What's the abundance? So these are, for our first comparison, we looked at healthy controls versus people who had dementia due to Alzheimer's disease. There was no differences in age, and not really differences in some of the other big things that might contribute to differences, for example, diabetes diagnosis. We also did some very general food questionnaires, and there didn't seem to be differences in diet. The consistency of your stool samples was similar across the groups. Of course, in people who had dementia due to Alzheimer's disease, there was differences in medication because the majority of those folks were taking medication for Alzheimer's. So here was one of our first findings, which is that among people with Alzheimer's disease, we see less diversity. So there's not as many, the species richness is different in people with Alzheimer's disease compared to the age-matched controls. We also found that there was, in what was there, we found differences in abundance. So, for example, there were certain species that were higher in Alzheimer's disease, and then a number of things that were lower in people who had dementia due to Alzheimer's disease. Then when we looked at the relationship with cerebral spinal fluid markers, this would tell us if the, for example, the bacteria were related to plaques and tangles. What we found was that in specific bacteria that were increased in Alzheimer's disease, across a number of them, they were actually related to how much plaques and tangles were present in the brain. And that was true even when we looked at people who didn't have dementia. If we just looked at people who were cognitively healthy, the levels of bacteria were related to how much proteins related to Alzheimer's we saw in the cerebral spinal fluid. So just, kind of the broad overview, in case these findings are hard to digest, we found that people with dementia as a group have differences in gut microbiome. It could be due to medication usage or diet differences. We didn't see broad differences in diet, but we didn't sort of get granular on that as well, so we might need to get more information there. But it is still interesting that even in people without dementia, we found these relationships with the CSF biomarkers. And then finally, our next step is going to be to do these animal studies. So we now have a germ-free Alzheimer's mouse. This is a mouse that overproduces amyloid. And we have this in Dr. Ray's lab. So now what we can do is actually take microbial communities, stool samples from a human volunteer, and give them to the mouse to see if that leads to more development of amyloid plaques and memory changes. So we have some flyers. We're actually still recruiting for this study. If you're interested in signing up, we're still looking for volunteers, and some of you that have already provided samples, we will probably follow up with you and ask if you'd be willing to give us another one as well. So thank you from all of us at the ADRC and on the MARS team, and look forward to receiving your samples. Thanks.